Somebody just take that.
For most students, technology is a tool that saves time and helps them research, explore, create.
Get a little bit of the treat.
For disabled students like Susanna Martini, technology is all of those things and much more. It is a lifeline.
Assistive technology is the major foundation of my life. Without it, I could not exist as I am today. I mean, without a computer, I couldn't do my homework.
Move left one word.
Without my chair, I couldn't get around. Without my cell phone, I couldn't, you know, call for help.
Active since she was born with cerebral palsy, Susanna refereed soccer matches from her wheelchair in high school. A sophomore at the University of Washington, she uses voice-activated software to complete her written assignments.
This is because computers involved electricity.
We all know how technology has improved in the last few years, all sorts of technology. What most people don't realize is that assistive technology, technology that helps people with disabilities use computers, has been progressing at the same rate.
Answer: air pressure prevents this from happening. Source: Stephen Hawking.
Even though there's a lot of technology available for people with disabilities, it isn't implemented that much in our school systems today. And there are a lot of reasons for that. One is that people who work with students with disabilities, this could be teachers, lab managers, parents, often aren't aware of the technology that is available for them. And then technology is not always included in the planning process.
Back in high school, they didn't understand that I needed a laptop and I needed a desk that could raise and lower, and I didn't have those things. I got a laptop after my mom made them get me one because she knows how to get through the red tape. But it's really necessary for anybody who has a disability to get what they need assistive technology-wise.
So the elevator controls what we call pitch.
The University of Washington's Disabilities, Opportunities, Internetworking, and Technology Program, or DOIT, helps students get the technology they need and holds summer workshops to help them prepare for college.
On this one, I agree that you found the rule.
Well, I use my laptop that I got from the DOIT program, and I use on-screen keyboard to type and to print and to surf the web.
Now I am ready for a bigger challenge.
Vishal Saraya was elected president of the Summit K-12 student body.
I'm Vishal Saraya, and I hope you vote for me.
And is planning to attend college next fall.
If they have access to their computers, they can take their own notes, they can take their own tests, they can write their own papers, they can use the internet and do their own research. These are things that they couldn't do in another way. They need to practice these independent skills so that they can move on to college and on to careers.
What was your favorite part that you learned about? Okay, go ahead.
The Northwest Indians.
Studies show that the earlier children are introduced to assistive devices, the quicker they master them.
Yeah. This morning I was mad.
Why were you mad,
Carlos?
Do you have? No. Try.
Because I didn't want to get up in the morning to go to school.
So at Redwood Heights Elementary in Oakland, California, the learning begins in preschool.
By introducing kids to technology early, it gets them better prepared and makes it easier down the road, and then they can spend the later years of their school years focusing on content material and the curriculum. Okay, what else?
The first task is to determine the best way for the child to access a device, whether it's the touch of a finger, a nod, or the twitch of an eyebrow.
It took us 3 years to figure Adrian out. He couldn't move any parts of his body except his eyebrow. And so we've determined that was the switch site, and then we determined which type of device would be used.
First, the device scans the rows, and then when he twitches his eyebrow, it begins to select the columns, so row column scan.
The devices are personalized with various icons, phrases, and voices, and can be programmed to let children share news from home with their classmates or tell their parents what they did in school.
We are learning about the solar system.
Where? Which class?
That's right.
Can you name some of the planets for us?
Mars.
I think we give something that's priceless, a voice, basically.
Pluto.
A lot of our kids are bright, and we give them that power. Who knows? Next one could be the next great physicist or next great scientist. I mean, we've got some wonderful kids with some wonderful minds.
For one student at Spokane's Meade High School, technology is the key to pursuing his passion. Lucas Bratcher loves to play his euphonium horn in the school jazz band, concert band, and even the marching band. That Lucas can play anywhere is a testament to his perseverance and the support of many people who help make his playing possible. It has been an uphill battle ever since he was born with a condition that renders his limbs nearly useless.
It's called amyoplasia arthrogryposis multiplex congenita, and it's throughout my four limbs, and it's basically, I have stiffness in my joints and some of my muscles aren't there.
But what's another name for one over sine theta?
Cosecant.
Cosecant theta.
Lucas hasn't let his disability prevent him from participating fully at school.
Times one over cosine theta.
Right.
He takes four advanced placement classes and does his homework on a laptop without the aid of the voice recognition software the school provided.
How about we move the knights there?
Lacking manual dexterity, Lucas learned to play music his own special way, to the amazement of his first band director.
He looked very eager and excited about being a member of the band, and quite honestly, my thought at that time was, oh my goodness, how could this possibly work? And as we took the students through their method book, I noticed that occasionally he would play on his horn. His hands were not able to activate the valves on the instrument, so it was apparent to me that what he was doing was just being selective about the notes that he was playing. He was willing to sit there and just wait for that one note to come along in the music. And when it came, he played it with all of his heart and enthusiasm and capability to make the best sound that he could. That was enough for him, initially.
But Lucas knew he could do more. And that's when serendipity led his mother to the instrument repair shop of Robin Amond.
I love repair. I mean, it's always different. You're always working on a different instrument. There's always different problems. My grandfather was a vaudeville musician. He lost his arm in a lumber mill accident. He put an ad in the Portland paper asking one-armed people if they're interested in learning music. He taught them how to play instruments.
The senior Amond also patented a device that allowed people with missing hands to play the piano.
I'd always wished that I could make something that could make a person who had lost an arm be able to take the place of their fingers. And then one night, I woke up in the middle of the night and I realized that joysticks aren't just for putting electrical things on screens. Joysticks can do other things. Joysticks can do mechanical things.
Amond's dream became a small box with a joystick that triggered solenoids and operated the valves of a horn. Learning a new way of playing was exhilarating and frustrating for Lucas, and just as he was getting the hang of playing it, someone took his horn.
Call Crime Check if you have any information. That number is
it was stolen in the morning, and by 5 o'clock that same day, I was getting the first call in my cell phone from an anonymous person that said that they wanted to contribute monetarily to a fund to either replace it or as a reward for it. And from that point on, it just snowballed into this huge, wonderful thing where the community raised $6,000.
You know, I wasn't quite sure where the optimum spot for the solenoids was going to be, so I wanted to be able to have it slide up and down.
The loss of the first horn became a blessing when mechanical engineer Andrew Coleman joined Amond to design a second, more responsive joystick and horn, which Lucas uses today.
When I heard and saw Lucas perform recently at a concert, it reminded me just how far we've come. And through the efforts of all the people that have been involved in supporting him, we caught on to his dream.
Technology has changed all of our lives, but for these students, technology truly changes their life and the opportunities that they'll have in the future.
I think assistive technology is going to allow me to major in communications and get a minor in disability studies. I actually want to be a news anchor.
I'm hoping to go to college on a music scholarship and study music and be a musician. I love to play.
For more information on what works in public education, go to edutopia.org.